Thank you, madam. And it's going to be diabetes in pregnancy before your tea break. And I'll be briefly discussing about the spectrum of diabetes in pregnancy, the disease burden, negative outcome of poorly controlled disease, preconception preparation, pathophysiology of diabetes in pregnancy, some light to antenatal and postnatal care when the patient is diagnosed with diabetes in pregnancy. So this is the traditional definition of gestational diabetes mellitus. It's an any degree of glucose intolerance with onset or the first recognition during pregnancy. So it's a spectrum. If we are to simplify, diabetes in pregnancy could be pre-existing diabetes or gestational diabetes developed in the second or third trimesters of the pregnancy. Pre-existing diabetes could be previously diagnosed and the your mother knows that she's a patient with diabetes or undiagnosed. So this is the 2019 type 2 diabetes atlas published by the International Diabetes Federation. We all know that the diabetes, type 2 diabetes around the world is in constant rise. I don't know whether it's very clear to you all, but if you look at that very carefully, there are certain regions to be considered. The African continent is leading the race, followed by the Middle East and North Africa, and we are in the third place. So by 2045, the increase of diabetes will be by 74% in our region. So what about the GDM? Of course, GDM prevalences are variable because of the different diagnostic cutoffs used and the different populations studied. So when it comes to Sri Lanka, there is a high prevalence. So these are the data I extracted from a study carried out in 2015. And what is the impact of uncontrolled disease? It starts on the fetus. It starts on the day one of gestation. It can complicate the pregnancy at any point, and it can complicate the labor immediate postnatal period. Not only that short-term period, but even after the delivery, the offspring of a mother having diabetes will develop at a higher risk of developing diabetes in later life with metabolic derangements and childhood obesity. What about the mother during the pregnancy? Their blood pressure is affected in a bad way. If they have pre-existing diabetes, their microvascular complications will be worsened. They're at a high risk of infections. The labor is complicated. Not only that, after the delivery, they're at a high risk of developing type 2 diabetes in later life. So what are the risk factors? South Asian ethnicity is a risk factor. So we carry a high risk of developing type 2 diabetes and gestational diabetes. If there is a first degree relative in your family with type 2 diabetes, they carry a high risk. And if your patient is more than 25 years, remember when we were medical students, age cutoff was more than 35, but now it has come down to 25. Previous pregnancies complicated with gestational diabetes, previous history of macrosomia, the presence of polycystic ovarian disease, being obese or overweight. So for us, BMI cutoff is more than 23, unlike Europeans, and certain medications like steroids. Therefore, not only patients with risk factors, all the patients who are willing to go through pregnancy is supposed to universally screen for diabetes before they go through the pregnancy. So different screening at different stages, at the preconception period, at the booking visit, and the second trimester, all should be screened for diabetes universally, irrespective of their age and the status of risk factors. When it comes to the third trimester, that may be decided by the treating physician or the VOG, whether they need to do another screening test. So I'm going to talk about this preconceptional preparation of women in reproductive age a bit, because if a patient or the, not the patient, a client enters the pregnancy with uncontrolled hyperglycemia without knowing that they have diabetes, it can have an adverse effect on the fetus. Because usually a female discovers that she's pregnant after about 6 weeks of gestation. By that time, most of the organogenesis has happened. So maternal hyperglycemia, uncontrolled maternal hyperglycemia, can seriously affect the fetus. Therefore, it is always very important to screen our clients before they enter the pregnancy. Therefore, take a couple of additional minutes to look for their fertility issues, screen them for diabetes, and categorize them whether it's normal or pre-diabetes or diabetes. If they have pre-diabetes, offer some lifestyle modifications. If they have diabetes, treat with appropriate medications, which could be continued to the pregnancy safely, and offer an appropriate contraceptive method until they reach their glycemic targets. The usual recommendation is to have a hemoglobin A1C less than 6.5. If they can reach it safely without hypoglycemia. For patients with pre-existing diabetes, look for microvascular complications because they can get worsened during the pregnancy. Add folic acid 5 milligrams per day, especially 3 months before stopping any contraception. So this is very important and probably the most important part of this lecture. So what happens to glucose metabolism in pregnancy? In simple ways, their fasting blood sugars are low because maternal glucose is diverted to the baby through a non-insulin dependent way. So it remains low during the pregnancy. Therefore, it is not a very good mark of the mother's glycemic status. When the pregnancy is advanced, placenta is formed. It is producing more placental hormones and inflammatory cytokines, which will give rise to reduced insulin sensitivity towards the second and third trimesters. At the same time, maternal hepatic gluconeogenesis is increased. Therefore, it's a kind of a glucose challenge to the mother at this moment. So what does her pancreas do? It tries to overcome this degree of insulin resistance. So it produces more insulin and at a lower threshold than a non-pregnant patient. If your patient has no problems, no pre-existing problems with insulin resistance or insulin secretion, she will manage to go through the pregnancy without having diabetes. But if there is any pre-existing defect, she will develop gestational diabetes. In addition to that, there are some new insights to the development of pathophysiology of diabetes in pregnancy, some genetics and epigenetics, certain metabolites like branch chain amino acids, and gut microbiomes. When it comes to the diagnosis, there are many controversies about diagnostic cutoffs. I'll discuss why it is a little later. But during the first trimester booking visit, you can use fasting OGTT or hemoglobin A1C. Cutoffs will be for non-pregnant people. But during the second trimester, the commonest practice is to conduct one step 75 gram OGTT. And there are again different cutoff values practiced by different associations. But the message I want to say is, you stick to what is familiar to you and be familiar with correctly interpreting the usual OGTT values. And this is why there are many debates about the cutoff values in diagnostic criteria. This is a very well-known study, which is commonly known as the Harper study and the Harper follow-up study. That study found that even mild maternal hyperglycemia can cause adverse fetal outcomes. Therefore, when it comes to some associations, they have become more stringent about their cutoff values. So if your patient has diabetes in pregnancy, there are a few management principles to be considered. The first one is glycemic control. It can be delivered in many ways. The first one is medical nutrition therapy, which is a very individualized program to be delivered to the patient very comprehensively. And the patient should be encouraged to stay physically active, provided that there are no contraindications from the obstetric side. And if there is any indication, we need to treat them appropriately. In addition to the glucose lowering therapy, you may consider starting low dose aspirin at the beginning of the second trimester to deal with any placental insufficiency. In addition to the glycemic control, you need to look after the blood pressure, intervene if there is any problem, and carefully look after the maternal weight gain, because it's a good indicator about the maternal eating patterns and the glycemic control. In addition to that, we have to look after the fetal health, usually by the obstetricians and serial ultrasound scans, if indicated any anomaly scans and amniotic fluid indices. So how are we going to deliver this kind of comprehensive care to the patient? The recommended way is to offer the plan of management through a shared care model like this, if facilities are available, because the patient and the family is the center, and we are in teams are going to collaborate with each other and to communicate with the patient, which is a very patient-friendly approach. So how are we going to monitor blood glucose during the pregnancy? The traditional and the commonest way is to do 2 weekly blood sugar series in the hospital. And that can be empowered by self-monitoring of blood glucose at home by using glucometers. And we know that it has limitations, but still we can ask them to get down their blood sugars frequently at home so they can recognize either hyperglycemia or hypoglycemia and discuss with their healthcare provider about medications and diet. Continuous glucose monitoring, which is not practiced in Sri Lanka, but some of you all may have seen that. It's a device attached to your body and it senses the glucose concentrations in your interstitial fluid and it gives out readings every 5 minutes. So it's a general indicator of your glycemic variability during the 24 hours. So it has its own advantages because it can again recognize hypos and hypers, and it's very flexible so patients can modify their insulin regimes and diet. So what are the recommended glycemic targets we are to achieve? Preprandial targets are less than 95, usually the fasting. 1 hour postprandial value is less than 140, and 2 hour postprandial value is less than 120, provided this can be achieved safely without hypoglycemia. But when it comes to pre-existing type 1 diabetes, it is very difficult to reach these glycemic targets because of the significant glycemic variability. In those moments, you might think of relaxing your glycemic targets. So during the intrapartum period, before that, we need to plan the delivery, the mode of delivery. Usually the delivery is planned around the 38 weeks of gestation, and look after the glycemic control during the labor. And it is recommended to maintain a blood glucose target of 70 to 110 during the intrapartum period. The insulin regimes used may be unique to the different units. So it's a kind of very personal plan of management. When it comes to the postpartum period, we need to support the mother to establish early breastfeeding and observe the baby for potential neonatal complications like neonatal hypoglycemia, respiratory distress syndrome. Usually, when the baby is born, mother is completely forgotten and they are physically and emotionally drained out, and they may have bled and the placenta has come out. Therefore, their insulin requirements go down and they might develop hypoglycemia during that period. Therefore, we have to monitor their blood sugars very carefully, adjust their medication, and support them to establish breastfeeding and to recover from the acute stressful period. So what are the long-term concerns? Type 2 diabetes in later life. Therefore, on discharge, if the blood sugars are normal, especially in gestational diabetes, don't say that you are well and safe, and you need to get back them to the clinic or wherever convenient for you and the patient to recheck for diabetes. So it is usually done when the baby is brought back to the hospital for vaccination. So plan an OGTT and interpret the OGTT and discuss about the OGTT results with your patient. If it is normal, ask them to repeat their blood sugars at least yearly or once in 3 years, depending on the risk. If it is abnormal, we have to direct them to follow up for life, long follow up for diabetes, and offer an appropriate contraception method and educate the family, especially the couple, on planning the next pregnancy. So the biggest struggle they face is non-achievement of ideal body weight after the pregnancy, because they receive a lot of information from different parts, relatives, in-laws, and colleagues. And they are also anxious about breastfeeding the child properly. So their eating habits get really, really chaotic. So this is the kind of body habitus changes a typical female in Sri Lanka can go through. At the beginning, they are very keen, but when it comes to caring for others, and they usually tend to forget about their body habitus. And the one here is metabolically deranged, and they might enter their second pregnancy like that, unprepared. So it's our responsibility to prevent that, help them to plan their next pregnancy in order to go through a healthy pregnancy. So I have copied this from the national guideline. So this cartoon simply explains the empowering women for a healthy nation. So it starts from the childbirth, the little child girl, and the eligible couples. So it's always important to empower young people to stay healthy, live healthy. As we discussed in the morning, we always find grade 1 fatty livers in all the ultrasound scan incidentally. So we can start it from here, from home. So before I finish, this is the important message I just wanted to deliver during this lecture. It's about empowering women in reproductive age group to prepare for the pregnancy and go through a very healthy and less complicated pregnancy. So when you prepare your patient, they are ready and steady and good to go. So, and if you remember that, you can forget the rest of the lecture today. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Aryavansa, for that very interesting and pretty simple lecture, which gives a very effective message at the end of it. Well done. We have 10 minutes for questions. So over to all of you to start questioning Dr. Aryavansa. Oh, yes, we have Dr. Boteju jumping up.
Thank you, Sharika, for that very informative and very timely discussion and the presentation. And now we have got some patients with polyhydramnios without a very obvious cause for the polyhydramnios. So having type 2 diabetes or else GDA. So what are the targets you would you like to advise for more stringent low values for PPBS 2-hour values or the same 120 value? Yeah.
If possible, yes. If they don't reach any, if they don't develop adversely hypoglycemic symptoms, we might go for lower. But these are the usual recommendations for a pregnancy.
Yeah. So because at Castle we practice, we try to keep it around 100 PPBS values after 2 hours. So that is our target when the patients are having polyhydramnios and type 2 diabetes without any other reason for the polyhydramnios. And the other thing is type 2 diabetes or GDM patients who are being pregnant, we start aspirin. Now we have increased to 150 because the FIGO guideline is that. Another thing is the fetal outcome is very good when you increase the aspirin dose to 150. That's the evidence.
Yes.
Other thing is once the patient is baby is delivered, then we stop all the antidiabetics, insulins, and oral hypoglycemia for type GDM, not for the type 2.
Yes.
Others only we continue and observe.
Yes, at a low dose probably.
Anyway, thank you very much for your good presentation.
Thank you.
I was intrigued that you advised to start folic acid 3 months before stopping contraception. Why 3 months before?
I mean, that's a usual recommendation, I mean, they give. So, before that, I mean, I have no idea why I say it, but that's a usual recommendation.
Is there any consensus now, Dr. Aryavansa, about the use of non-insulin antidiabetics in pregnancy, or are we still not too sure?
Non-insulin injectables, so?
Both.
Non-insulin injectables, not yet.
Okay.
But when it comes to oral oral hypoglycemic medications, metformin is considered as a second line. And in some countries, glibenclamide can be used, yes, glyburide, especially in USA. But safety data are lacking, and both can cross the placenta. So the safest is insulin. And if the patient is unable to take insulin for some reason, as the second line, we can offer oral hypoglycemic agents, metformin and glibenclamide.
So even if they are very well controlled on metformin and or for some other reason like PCOS, you still advise that they be changed over?
Metformin.
Yes.
Yes, it can be continued. Yes.
Then it can be continued.
Yes. Not in our guideline. Yes. US, yes, yes. They have the variation called glyburide.
Same thing, yeah.
And our line, first line is still the metformin.
Metformin.
Yeah, yeah.
I do get many referrals from the office unit that their blood pressures are at least marginally high. Sometimes they do perform 24 hours BP monitoring. So would you like to tell us what are the targets for blood pressure, if not in your BP, Surango, anybody would like?
It's usually 130 by 85. They don't recommend very low blood pressures because it can adversely affect the fetal perfusion. So especially if the patient has pre-existing microvascular disease like nephropathy, so we have to decide an individual target and reach that target for that individual patient.
Yeah, now increased blood sugar is a risk factor for pre-eclampsia. So we have had a few maternal deaths due to preeclampsia and diagnosed and lately diagnosing. So the target blood pressure is 140-90. Higher than that, we have to closely monitor the mother. And 130-85 is for the patients who are on treatment for PIH. The target is the 130-85, but for diagnosis, we use 140-90. If it is 140-90, make sure that it's not preeclampsia. Otherwise, we have to go for this all these maternal meetings and, you know, interviews. So we have to be careful. So if it's 140-90, look for any symptoms of preeclampsia with regard to the trimester. And then look for urine albumin. And please monitor. And best thing is to, if you are busy, admit and monitor the patient for high blood pressure. because diabetes in pregnancy is a risk factor for preeclampsia also.
So with that, we will bring this session to a close. Before that, can I please ask my co-chair, Dr. Vithanagi, to hand over a token of appreciation from the Ceylon College of Physicians to Dr. Aryavansa.